Good morning, everybody. I'm really, really happy to see that you came all this early in the morning to talk about the most important parts of breast cancer management, and that's local treatment. This morning, it's about local treatment, and the organization selected a couple of subjects in local treatment in surgery, which is debatable. For instance, what's still the role of central node biopsy, the bilateral mastectomy, local surgery in the elderly, and of course surgery after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. I am very happy to co-chair this session. The chair is Professor Jiming Xiao. He is a professor of surgery, breast surgery, at the Fudan University in Shanghai. And he is heading, if not the largest breast unit you can imagine, treating almost 6,000 patients a year. So what I am, I don't know what my, I'm a very small boy. Okay. So let's go for the first speaker, and I'm really happy to introduce Dr. Paolo Veronesi. And he is going to talk about controversies. He doesn't need any introduction, of course. I think he is from France or something, huh? Yeah. And the standards, well, and controversies in central node biopsy, if there is any. Paolo, please.
Thank you, Emil. Good morning, early morning to everybody. So it is a bit difficult to talk again about sentinel node biopsy, because at the beginning of this conference, at least two talks were done about this topic. But I will try to summarize and especially to share with you our experience. In fact, our institute started its activity in 1994, exactly the same year Morton published the first paper on sentinel node biopsy in melanoma patients, opening the way to the sentinel node era. And to date, we performed almost 40,000 sentinel node biopsies in breast cancer patients. And this is the number of every year sentinel biopsy we do, more than 2,200 every year. So after validation studies to compare sentinel node biopsy to axillary status with the complete axillary dissection, randomized studies started to validate the new method, and we published the first randomized study in 2003 on New England Journal of Medicine on more than 500 patients, and the results were confirmed by the larger multicentric B32 study by Craig and other authors in the United States. Both these studies showed no difference in overall survival and disease free survival in both groups, but both studies showed also a false negative rate of sentinel node in about 8-9% of patients. So when at the beginning of 2000 we started to apply this new technique on all patients, our first concern was about the risk of axillary reappearance, considering this 8-9% of false negative rate. So we decided to follow up a large number of patients, more than 5,000 patients, for a long period, 10 years, to assess the risk of axillary reappearance of the disease. And so we expected about 8% of reappearance, but we observed only 1.3% of reappearance of the disease in the axilla. So we can say that sentinel node biopsy is the standard treatment for breast cancer care in patients with negative, clinically negative axilla. There are, however, some controversies. First of all, axillary management in sentinel node biopsy positive patients. Then what to do in sentinel node, with sentinel node in advanced breast cancer after neoadjuvant treatment. And the last question nowadays is if sentinel node biopsy is really mandatory in all invasive cancers. So sentinel node positive patients, the standard of care nowadays is to do axillary dissection if we found two, three or more positive nodes at the sentinel node biopsy. And we are talking about breast conservative surgery plus whole breast irradiation. The first two studies to assess that axillary dissection was not mandatory in patients with the positive axillary node was the AMAROS trial, in which patients were randomized. It was published in 2014, and in patients were randomized in sentinel node positive cases between axillary dissection and radiotherapy on the axilla, and there was no difference in disease-free survival and in overall survival, and the axillary recurrence rate was very low in both groups, 0.43% in the axillary lymph node dissection and 1.19% in the axillary radiotherapy group. So radiotherapy of the axilla instead of surgery provides excellent regional control and reduces the risk of short-term and long-term lymphedema compared to axillary dissection. But this does not mean that axillary radiotherapy is necessary in all patients with the positive sentinel node, because we have, as you know, the results of the Z11 trial, in which included patients with metastasis, both micro and macro metastasis, in breast conservative surgery. The design of the study was very simple, T1, T2, and 0, M0 patients, breast cancer patients, with one or two positive sentinel node were randomized between axillary dissection and no further axillary treatment, and then follow-up. And the long term, almost 10 years of follow-up, show no difference in local regional recurrences in two groups, especially in nodal recurrences. Axillary nodal recurrences were 1.5% in the sentinel node alone group, compared with 0.5% in the axillary dissection group. And of course, no difference in disease-free survival and overall survival between the two groups. There was some critics to this work. The main objection is that the patients who were included were likely selected, even though this was an American multicentric study with 177 participating centers. Only half of the initially planned patients were included over a 5-year period. And the majority of patients had favorable prognostic factors. And in regard to the sites of sentinel node metastasis, the distribution was skewed between the groups, with more isolated tumor cells and micrometastasis in the group that was randomized to observation alone. Moreover, this study included patients only submitted to conservative surgery plus radiotherapy. But it is a matter of fact that the study changed dramatically the surgical practice of breast cancer and nowadays we do a lot of we do less and less axillary dissection than in the past. So we applied these criteria to our patients starting 3 years ago in 2016. And this is, of course, we stopped to do frozen section of sentinel node during the operation, as we did before. We do quadrantectomy and sentinel node biopsy and sent for definitive examination. And our concern, of course, was the risk of re-operate the patient for a second operation because two or more, more than two sentinel nodes were positive. But this is our first cases, 1,386 patients. Most of them, 83% of them, had sentinel node negative. 213 had positive sentinel node, but only 7 patients needed a second operation. And 4 of these patients, because there were more than 3 or more positive nodes, and 3 of them because they need to undergo a mastectomy for positive margin. So this means that only 3% of patients need a second operation, 3% of positive node patients, but only 0.5% of all patients in which we apply the Z11 criteria. These are the characteristics of our patients. Of course, the main factors influencing the risk of positive sentinel node is the peritumoral vascular invasion, 47% of patients compared with only 12% in node negative patients. These are the number of removed lymph nodes in the 7 patients who had the second surgery. In 3 of them, all the other lymph nodes were negative. So in line with the Z11 trial results, the current surgical indication in breast conserving surgery does not justify axillary lymph node dissection in T1, T2 breast cancer with only 1 to 2 positive sentinel nodes. Conversely, if more than three or more sentinel nodes are positive or a macroscopic lymph node is found intraoperatively, then axillary lymph node dissection is still strongly recommended. And what about axillary radiotherapy? We can consider in selected cases axillary radiotherapy on other axillary nodes, according to Monica Morrow, when we have large tumors, more than 3 centimeters, peritumoral vascular invasion, or microscopic extracapsular extension of metastasis. We have also our guidelines about radiotherapy, in which we consider axillary radiotherapy based on biological features of the tumor. So we consider breast plus axillary irradiation in more aggressive tumor like HER2 positive or triple negative cancers. And what about mastectomy patients nowadays? If a macrometastasis is found in sentinel node biopsy, we do complete axillary dissection in all patients. So we perform frozen section of the sentinel node during the operation. While if we find only micrometastasis, no axillary dissection is done. So axillary dissection is indicated because this group of patients was excluded from the Z11 trial. However, there are some trials ongoing, like the Senomac trial. I go faster, and this trial has a primary endpoint of breast cancer specific survival, and the eligibility criteria are very similar to the Z11, but also patients undergo mastectomy can be enrolled in the trial. And radiotherapy is not extended or changed based on which arm the patient is randomized to, because sentinel biopsy should only be regarded as a substitute for axillary clearance. So the only exception is the case of sentinel node with the micrometastasis, the only exception to axillary dissection. In these cases, axillary lymph node dissection is not indicated and represents an over-treatment. In fact, we have the results of the trial, multicentric study 23-01 of the International Breast Cancer Study Group. We published the recent follow-up in the last year, with a median follow-up of almost 10 years. In this trial, patients with micrometastasis were randomized between axillary dissection or observation only, independently of the type of treatment, so conservative surgery and mastectomy. And there were no difference in overall and disease-free survival in both groups, with a very low risk of axillary reappearance of the disease, only 0.4% in the axillary dissection group and 1.7% in the no axillary dissection group. So to summarize the recommendations, breast conservative surgery, we do axillary dissection when there are three or more sentinel nodes positive, and in mastectomy when we found macrometastasis of at least one sentinel node. What about the patient for advanced breast cancer after neoadjuvant treatment? We agreed with the next speaker, Professor Fitzal, to leave him this topic, so I will not try treat this topic. Only show you our experience of a retrospective study on almost 400 patients who were N0 after neoadjuvant treatment and who received breast sentinel biopsy. Of course, the prognosis was influenced by the sentinel node status. It was better in sentinel node negative patients, and this was particularly important in patients who have complete pathological response on the breast, which we did with the positive lymph node before neoadjuvant treatment, 38 patients. When the sentinel node was also negative, the prognosis was very good. And we must say, in these patients, we observed only one case of axillary reappearance of the disease. So these preliminary results suggest that sentinel node biopsy is a safe procedure for T1-T2 patients with negative axillary staging after neoadjuvant treatment. And to conclude, the last question, if sentinel node is really mandatory in all invasive cancer, what are the reasons for not doing sentinel node biopsy? But first of all, sentinel node biopsy has lost much of its importance, because at the beginning we did the sentinel node biopsy to decide if perform axillary dissection or not, but nowadays we don't do axillary dissection not only when the sentinel node is negative, but also when it is micrometastatic and or macrometastatic in conservative surgery. Moreover, imaging technology can identify smaller axillary involvement and may be used for axillary staging. And most important, adjuvant treatment nowadays depends mostly on primary tumor biology than on axillary status. So 6 years ago, we planned to do the SOUND trial, a multicentric international study. I must say that we enrolled almost half of the patients, 46% of the patients in our institution. The design of the study is very simple. Patients with up to 2 centimeter breast cancer are submitted to axillary ultrasound assessment, of course, with clinically negative nodes. If negative, the patient is eligible for the study and is randomized between sentinel node biopsy and subsequent axillary dissection, if positive, and observation. We randomized 1,463 women. 47 were excluded for the analysis, so we have 708 patients in both groups. The primary endpoint was distant disease-free survival. Secondary endpoints, axillary failures, disease-free, and overall survival, quality of life, type of adjuvant treatment, and false negative rate on axillary ultrasound. We closed the accrual in June 2017 because of many reasons. First of all, the number of patients enrolled was very close to the planned sample size, over 93%. Interim analysis showed on both arms a very low number of events. But most important, the standard of care of positive sentinel patients was changed, so it was very difficult to enroll new patients because patients in this study were submitted to axillary dissection if sentinel node was positive, as the study was designed many years ago. The patient's characteristics shown a difference in the two groups, exactly the same. As regard to sentinel node status, we found 13.7% of positive nodes in the sentinel node group. And this is the numbers. The characteristic was actually the same in the two groups. This is the detail of lymph node status. Of course, in patients who not underwent sentinel node biopsy, the physical function of the upper limb was better than the patients submitted to sentinel node biopsy. And of course, I don't have the results about overall survival and the primary endpoint, but we recently submitted a paper on the adjuvant treatment because, as you can imagine, the concern was that the information about sentinel node, the loss of information about sentinel node, finished. Of sentinel node can change the adjuvant treatment, but fortunately the adjuvant treatment was exactly the same in the two groups, as you can see, in the indication of hormonal or chemotherapy was exactly the same in the two groups of patients. So the information on sentinel node doesn't change the indication of adjuvant treatment. So this is my conclusion. I will conclude telling that in the future axillary surgery will probably be limited to those patients who have an overt axillary disease without indication or after neoadjuvant treatment, and to those patients who will experience another relapse after treatment. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Paolo. In face of time, just one question from Miguel Knauer. Number three.
Yes, Michael Knauer from St. Gallen. You have shown about 14% positive nodes even after negative ultrasound. The exactly same number was observed in a German study in the INSEMA that you didn't mention now. But also in your previous series, you had only 14% to 15% positive nodes without doing this. Do you think this is necessary, this ultrasound staging, or can we even skip this?
But the problem with ultrasound is that can lead to a higher number of axillary dissection, because when we found a positive positive node on the ultrasound confirmed by cytology, nowadays we do axillary dissection instead of sentinel node. This is a problem. So I don't think in the future will be necessary to do ultrasound in all patients.
Thank you. Thank you, Paolo, again for this very nice overview. I hand over the mic to